glad that you guys joined us this evening. My name is Emily Russell, and I have the privilege of working here at Clearview as the Director of Marketing and Business Development. And I'm so excited that you guys are here tonight. So if you have shoulder pain, raise both your arms like this. No, I'm just kidding. My guess is if you have shoulder pain, that's why you're here this evening, and perhaps that motion can be a bit painful, if not impossible at times. So we are so excited to have with us one of our premier orthopedic surgeons here at Clearview, Dr. David Harkins. He is a fantastic and phenomenal doctor. I've heard many of you mention that he's your doctor. He's my doctor. He operated on my knee last summer, and it's great. I can do cartwheels now. It's wonderful. So without any further ado, I'll just turn it over to you, Dr. Harkins.
Don't rub it on too thick.
That's right. I'll try not to. All right.
Well, thank you so much for coming tonight. I want to thank Emily and Clearview for hosting tonight, for helping to put this together, and for my team with Christy Ellis passing out some napkins and other things back there in the back. She runs the show out here for us in this area, and for Jocelyn Wyckoff, who couldn't be here tonight. But first of all, I want to thank you guys for coming out tonight. When I got done with surgery today and walked outside, I thought, well, no one's going to show up tonight. So thank you all for braving the weather tonight to come out to hear me speak and hopefully say something that speaks to you and brings you back. Just a little bit about myself. I've now been in Monroe and the Walton County area for a little over 10 years now. And I see some current patients and former patients out in the audience tonight, and I appreciate you coming. We've enjoyed living here and providing good service to the community for the past 10 years. First, I started opening up a orthopedic practice on my own called Providence Orthopedics, joined shortly thereafter by Dr. Shane Smith. Recently, about 5 years ago, we joined teams with Athens Orthopedic Clinic and have been growing strong ever since. We currently have locations all over. I go to four of them here in Monroe, Covington, Loganville, and in Snellville. So we're just about anywhere you can be, and if you need to make an appointment, I think we have an office near you. So tonight I want to talk a little bit about the upper extremity and shoulder. It's kind of near and dear to my heart. It's what I trained in. I do a little bit of everything in orthopedics other than spine. I let my partners take care of the spine. But I do a little bit of everything, sports medicine and total joint replacement. But I'm a specialist in shoulder and elbow problems. I did some extra training in my training called a fellowship, where I trained with some premier surgeons out at Baylor University Medical Center in Dallas, Texas, for a year after I finished my residency program in nothing but shoulder problems. Did a lot of shoulder replacement surgery that year, as well as rotator cuffs and other issues. So tonight I'd like to talk a little bit about shoulder pain, but specifically as it relates to shoulder arthritis. So we start just with a little overview of the anatomy, and I know this picture on the left here is not all that clear, so I did bring a model with me, but that's basically showing the bony anatomy of the shoulder. And the shoulder is essentially a ball and socket joint. So you've got the ball, which is your humerus. The top of it makes up the ball of the shoulder. And then you have the socket, which is the curved area here on the scapula or the shoulder blade. And together they make up the shoulder joint, along with the muscles and ligaments that hold it in place. And that up here on the right, you'll see some of the rotator cuff muscles and some of the other ligaments and muscles that help hold the shoulder in place. But here in the front, you've got one of the rotator cuff muscles, and on top, the one that normally tears, called the supraspinatus. And the rotator cuff is actually made up of four muscles. They surround the shoulder, they support the shoulder, they force the ball into the socket, so then the bigger muscle, the deltoid, can lift the shoulder up over your head and help rotate the arm around. Right here you see the biceps muscle, and it sends a tendon up into the shoulder on the front of the shoulder, and it actually attaches to the top of the socket there. I don't know if all of you can see that, but we can pass this around later. So that's just kind of a brief overview of the shoulder anatomy. So when patients come to my office, they don't typically come and say, I've got arthritis in my shoulder. They come to me and they say, I've got shoulder pain. And it's up to me to figure out what's going on in the shoulder. So here are just a few issues that can be going on in the shoulder, and I've got to figure out what the diagnosis is, and then figure out the best treatment options. So most of you have heard of slap tears and instability of the shoulder dislocating, some bursitis or impingement, which is a very common problem, rotator cuff tears, some fractures, and even essentially osteoarthritis of the shoulder. So just some pictures of those. On the upper left there is a rotator cuff tear. Certainly a very common complaint in patients older than 50. About one quarter of the population has a rotator cuff tear. If you're older than 70, about half, 50% of people have rotator cuff tears. And so I see a lot of rotator cuff tears, and I fix a lot of rotator cuff tears. In fact, today I fixed two of them. Fractures, proximal humerus fractures or shoulder fractures, are pretty common. I do a lot of those. Shoulder dislocations down here. Shoulder impingement is kind of a consortium of several things. You can get some rotator cuff tendonitis, some inflammation in the bursa, which is a potential sac of fluid that protects the rotator cuff and the outer bones of the shoulder. As you raise your shoulder up, it gets pinched in between the top of the shoulder here and the top of the shoulder blade. And that can cause bursitis. And so that's essentially what shoulder impingement is impinging the shoulder bursa between these two bones and causing shoulder bursitis. And we can talk about that a little bit if you want to later on, but we'll press on with the shoulder arthritis talk. Down here is an x-ray of shoulder arthritis, what that looks like, and kind of a drawing of what that means. So essentially, you know, God gave us a protective covering of cartilage on all of our joints. And when that wears off, then we have shoulder arthritis. So as we wear through that protective covering of cartilage, we eventually get down to bone-on-bone arthritis, and we're rubbing bone on bone. So it's not just the knees and the hips that we're talking about anymore, it's the shoulders as well. And shoulder arthritis is becoming more and more prevalent. So typically when patients come in complaining of shoulder pain, I listen to what their signs and their symptoms are, what makes them hurt, what brings on that pain, what makes it worse. Then I do a physical exam, and then take some x-rays, and with that information, I can tell you with most certainty what's going on in your shoulder. If you come in with an x-ray like this, there's no doubt about it. You've got shoulder arthritis. So what is arthritis? It's osteoarthritis, essentially, is what I just said. It's wearing out that protective covering of cartilage so that you've got no more barrier in the joint itself, and you're rubbing bone on bone. That creates pain, that creates inflammation in your joint. It is associated with wear and tear. It's typically not associated with an injury, although you can have an injury and have resultant arthritis years later. People that dislocate their shoulders multiple times typically will develop some arthritis later. If you have surgery for shoulder dislocations, you can develop arthritis later on. If you have a rotator cuff tear that is not that goes untreated, you can develop arthritis later on. Typically with osteoarthritis, it develops in the 50s and 60s and later in life, but it can develop earlier in life. I do have some 40-year-olds and younger with pretty significant shoulder arthritis. Some are from injuries that they sustain while playing football or lifting weights or whatever, but some are, there's a propensity of hereditary arthritis as well. That we can get this from mom and dad and, you know, on down the line. So there's some of that as well. Some people are born with problems that lead to arthritis later on as well. But typically, as you wear through the cartilage and you're rubbing bone on bone, that causes pain with any range of motion. Any place, anywhere you try to move this shoulder, that causes pain. There's really not a whole lot of relief from that. The arthritis, the bone-on-bone rubbing, also causes inflammation in the joint. And it is progressive. It will get worse. Once you develop arthritis, it is going to progress. I see people all the time who tell me, well, I thought it would just get better, so I didn't do anything about it. And it's just gotten worse and worse and worse, and now I can't hardly move my shoulder. But that's pretty much the general progression of arthritis. It will progress, it will get worse, especially in the shoulder, as you try to guard your shoulder and stop moving your shoulder to eliminate the pain or help the pain, that causes stiffness in the shoulder. And so as you, it hurts to move your shoulder, so you stop moving that shoulder and then you develop more arthritis and more stiffness in the shoulder, which makes things worse. It compounds things. So what are the treatment options for arthritis? As I said before, rubbing bone on bone in the shoulder, or any joint for that matter, causes pain and causes inflammation. So one of the things that we use, all of our tricks in our bag to treat arthritis deal with getting the inflammation down, which in turn gets the pain better. So we use anti-inflammatory medications. Those are either taken by mouth, or now in the past couple of years they've come out with some anti-inflammatory medicines that are in a gel form or a cream form. And you can rub that on the shoulder and it'll penetrate through the skin down to the joint. And very little of it will go down, will go through the bloodstream, and none of it goes through the GI tract. So if you have an ulcer, you can still have some anti-inflammatory medications. So that's provided a good bit of relief for people that couldn't take anti-inflammatory medicines before. The other thing that I'll typically do is a steroid injection. And steroid is essentially a high-powered anti-inflammatory medicine. So it's going to get to the root of the problem. You're going to inject it right into the joint, into that between the ball and the socket, which is where the inflammation and the pain are coming from, and inject the steroid medicine there to decrease the inflammation and help with your pain. Now these are not going to get rid of your arthritis, but they're going to help for a while. It is a band-aid of sorts, but eventually you can come back to this over and over. So you can inject the shoulder about every 3 to 4 months to decrease the inflammation, decrease the pain. If you're not ready to have surgery for your shoulder, that is an option. So you don't want to do that forever, but you can do it until you're ready to have surgical intervention. And also physical therapy. As I mentioned before, most people will stop moving their shoulder very well, and as they stop moving their shoulder, they get stiff. Also the bone spurs that are created with glenohumeral arthritis or shoulder arthritis prevent motion as well. Typically you're going to lose the motion first here in what we call external rotation. Instead of being able to turn out 90 degrees like this, you'll start noticing I can only turn out to 60 degrees. I can only turn out to 45 degrees. 30 degrees and eventually zero. And I've even seen some people that couldn't even get to zero. Zero is straight out in front of you, or neutral. So as you progress through this process, the more you create friction in your joint, the more your body will create more bone. And that's called bone spurs, and that's going to prevent your motion as well as the pain and inflammation. So the focus of physical therapy is not to eliminate your pain, is to try to maintain as much motion as we can before surgery. If you can maintain your motion, typically you can prolong having to have surgery. When your motion starts to decline, you're leaning towards, your options are getting thin. So finally, last but not least, in the cascade of treatment options for shoulder arthritis is shoulder replacement. Now, essentially, you've worn out your joint, so you're going to replace the joint. And the shoulder arthritis, shoulder replacement was actually thought of or performed before knee and hip replacement. It didn't turn out so well the first time around, but that's the natural history of it. Now we've gotten much better over the years, and that's why I'm here talking to you about it now. But shoulder replacement essentially will relieve the pain. It gets rid of the arthritis. So you're cutting out the arthritis and replacing it with metal implants and plastic implants that will take the place of your shoulder and become your new shoulder. So that in and of itself gets rid of the cause of the pain, and it's pretty predictable. The only reason really though to proceed with shoulder replacement is for retractable pain. You can't get better with anything else we've tried. We've tried some anti-inflammatory medicines, and at first they'll help. Eventually they'll stop working for you. The intra-articular steroid injections. At first you'll get some pretty good relief from them. Eventually they will work less and less, and eventually not help you much at all. The physical therapy, instead of helping you, it's causing some pain now because it hurts to move your shoulder in any plane. That's the time that you want to talk about shoulder replacement. And that's really the reason to do shoulder replacement, is get rid of your pain and to treat your motion and try to improve your function. So like I said, the first shoulder replacement was actually performed in 1893 for, of all things, tuberculosis. And it didn't turn out all that well, had to be taken back out. And for a while, people steered away from shoulder replacements, but it was really popularized by a very famous orthopedic surgeon by the name of Charles Neer in the 1970s and 80s. And he really pioneered shoulder replacement as we know it now. He developed the prostheses that are essentially the same as he initially developed, just with some modifications since then. He did most of the initial studies that we now have that are considered the landmark studies. And the guys that he trained are now in the big programs, training guys up under them to come out replacing shoulders. There have been multiple advancements over the years, especially since the 1970s, but really in the past 10 years, I've seen a lot of advancements with shoulder replacement surgery. Used to, we could only tell people that they would last for about 10 years, and that's all the data we had on shoulder replacement surgery. But now the recent articles are showing pretty good survival rates at 20 years, and so that's a huge deal. It's the same thing with hips and knees. You know, as the advancement got better and better, and more people put them in and made advancements in the designs, they're lasting a good 20 years now as well. And so we've gotten there with shoulder replacements now, there finally as well. So that we can tell people now there's a pretty good survival rate at 15 years, on the order of about 85 to 90%, and the same at about 20 years. So they're gaining in popularity, and that's a large part because of guys like me that are doing shoulder fellowships and coming out and doing shoulder surgery. People are finding out about it, and more people are interested in it now. No longer do you have to live the rest of your life with the bum shoulder that hurts all the time. You've got something you can do about it now. So with shoulder replacement, like I said before, it is very predictable in the amount of pain relief you get from it. I can typically replace a shoulder. They'll typically stay one night in the hospital. I can walk in the room the next morning, and the pain they have before surgery is gone. And I have not had one person tell me the difference. So I typically will ask that. And they will have some pain from surgery, but the pain that they have is different. So it predictably takes that arthritis type pain away immediately. And it restores motion. It puts things back to where they need to be. It restores how the shoulder was put together by God in the first place. Albeit not your natural parts, but it allows the body to take over once you go through physical therapy again to get stronger. Your motion improves and your function improves. So this is just a few pictures. This is a shoulder before surgery. You can see that the joint here is not smooth anymore. It kind of looks like a pothole in the road that's been worn away. It was painful all the time, and we went and replaced the shoulder joint, and they did very well with that. And here's a young lady who's very happy with her shoulder replacement, and you can see the amount of motion that she got after that. So the post-operative motion in this shoulder looks like the other shoulder. So her post-operative motion matches her pre-operative motion of her other shoulder. And so that's the kind of motion that you could expect to get. Now, not everybody gets there to full motion, but the great majority do. And if you can relieve your pain and restore motion to your shoulder again, most people are pretty happy with that. So typically, when I do a shoulder replacement, it's a one-night stay. Most people are going home the following day. Sometimes they'll stay for either medical reasons or some pain in the shoulder for a second night. Typically, I'll put patients in a shoulder immobilizer because there is one of the rotator cuff muscles I have to take down off the bone and then repair it at the end of the case. So that muscle has to heal, so we have to give it some time to heal. I do put you in a shoulder immobilizer for 6 weeks. That allows that muscle to heal down. Without that muscle, you won't have the force couples around the shoulder to be able to get the motion that you want. So that muscle needs to heal down during that first 6 weeks. And then after that, I put you into physical therapy, and we'll work on number one, getting the motion back, and then number two, getting your strength back to restore your motion. And that's pretty much all I have for you. I'm happy to answer any questions. Hopefully I explained things well enough for you to make an informed decision. So I'll open the floor to any questions right now. Yes, ma'am.
What are some other reasons you might need to have a shoulder replacement?
Well, there's a variety of reasons. For a standard shoulder replacement, it's what we just talked about. Now, if you have a rotator cuff tear that it cannot be repaired anymore, we can do a shoulder replacement that's different from what I just described. It's where we put the ball on the socket and the socket on the ball, and I think I have a picture of it. Here. So this goes on the socket, that ball, and then the socket goes on the in the humerus. So this becomes the socket, this becomes the ball, and then they rotate, they fit together like that, and that's how you get your motion.
Okay.
pretty good motion, pretty restores the motion and the function pretty well with that prosthesis.
Why would they do that? Why change?
Well, we had no other, well, it's not changing just a standard total joint or a total shoulder. This is someone who does not have a rotator cuff anymore. So this compensates for a rotator cuff. So you don't have the muscles holding the shoulder in place anymore. So the shoulder will rise up. So it'll contact, the ball will come in contact with the top of the
process. Yeah.
Correct. And so you lose the motion. And most of these patients, when they get further along, they don't really have much motion. So they can't really move their shoulder anymore. So this has provided us with a way to treat that we couldn't do until 2004. And so that compensates for someone who does not have a shoulder rotator cuff anymore.
What does visco supplementation consist of?
Well, visco supplementation, if you do the injections you're talking about, mm-hmm. There are a variety of companies that make a gel. It's mostly made in the lab, depending on which company you go with. It's essentially made to be consistent with your joint fluid. And injecting visco supplementation or a gel into your joint or add more fluid into your joint, it's essentially like putting oil in your car. You put oil in your car to decrease the friction in your engine parts so they don't wear out. You put visco supplementation into your joint to increase the amount of fluid you have in the joint, to decrease the friction you have in your joint, to hopefully help keep it from wearing out.
Hello, Walton County. This is Kevin Littlewood, Chairman's Report on Channel 16, Walton Entertainment. Happy New Year. It's January 2016. We finally went from the 70s and 80s of December to the 20s and 30s of January. So we hope we're going to have a few months of winter here. We've just completed last couple of weeks, we had close to 14 inches of rain in different areas of the county. Actually, most of the areas in Walton County had somewhere between 10 to 14 inches of rainwater. And a lot of roads were pipes were carrying it to the capacity, and even some had water across it. And a lot of people that have moved in over the last several years realized that their area in their yard, their low spots, caught a lot of water, and water may even stood and got under your house. And so it's one of those situations where, you know, our pipes were acting like they were supposed to, moving the water across, and we only lost Hestertown Road, which is on the southeast end of the county down between Union Chapel and Ebenezer. That don't really know what caused that pipe to fail, but it did, and it blowed the road out down there. South Cross Lane and North Cross Lane up near Bowl Springs and Providence Club, those two roads generally do go under if we have a major storm event or rain, because they're still dirt roads, and one of them runs right along the Appalachian River, and the other one is over at the beginning of the Alcove River. And so those areas there just have never been really upgraded because of it being a dirt road and still there. But all in all, our road crew's done very well to keep the people traveling. We monitor them 24 hours as we're going into the holidays there, Christmas Eve, Christmas Day, and even around New Year's Eve there, we were still having a good bit of rain here. And so I want to commend our public works crews that worked throughout the night and worked to keep you traveling and keep you going here in the county. And as I speak on the rains, I anticipate some snow or ice or something like that coming in January or February. And so keep monitoring the local TV, local Facebook sites. We'll be updating you what's going on there if we do have any kind of closings or anything out like that, because you know, it's January, February generally here in Georgia, and it is probably some of the coldest times that we have, and we will update you if we have any snow or ice. Going on to the construction scene, I was going to let you know it's after January 1st, the Charlotte-Rowell Boulevard, they should be starting sometime soon on that extra lane. which will be running westbound on the side of 138 Charlotte Rowell, running out into Martin Luther King Boulevard out in front of Tractor Supply, and that'll be moving a lot of traffic on. Going to take about 3 to 5 months to get that done, depending on how the weather is and how the traffic, if they can move the traffic through to be able to work and get that going on really well. I think that will make a big difference on a lot of the volume moving from the 138 end off of 78 through that little intersection out there. But as you know, Moe's is opening there, Dunkin' Donuts is opening. I hear there's going to be a Firehouse Subs and even Burger King at the end of the Walmart parking lot. So, you know, there's going to continue to be delays, going to be continue to be a lot of cars in that area right there at 138 and 10, because there's just not enough area to move your cars. The City of Monroe and Walton County and Georgia DOT are evaluating to see what other areas we can improve right there to try to move people through, try to signalize, do timing on the signals to try to help you. So just don't get frustrated. It's just a volumes deal there. I come through Loganville on Monday this week, and on 78 coming from Snellville, I had to set through three traffic signals right in downtown Loganville just to get through. So, you know, that's one of the things of a lot of people coming. We're going to have some growing pains, and that's some of them. But we are, be mindful that we are working on that and looking at what we can do to make things go forward. And on another note, I want to talk a little bit about Hardlever Creek. Hardlever Creek Reservoir, as I've showed you pictures of, is on the south end of the county, down right out from Social Circle. That reservoir is, we got caught a good break on all the rain from the good Lord, and we are somewhere around 750 acres underwater. You know, that's a 1,300 plus acre reservoir, maybe even close to 1,500 time you get all the outer edges there. And so we've got a lot of water in there. Matter of fact, it rose in the last week of December close to 6 feet. And we're at the point where we can only raise it 1 foot a week. So we're talking with EPA right now, seeing what we need to do. We are letting the water out as fast as it can go out, but we also are, the boat ramp is under construction down there. So we got a lot of things that we wasn't anticipating, this large amount of water. But way back when this site was chosen back in the 90s, it was the largest drainage basin for a reservoir that they were looking at. And so this kind of proves it now. You know, everybody was saying that the little creeks, the little streams, they would never fill up. But I mean, if you hadn't had a chance on South Circle Fair Play, make sure you ride down and look at it, because it's filling up. But we've come a small portion right now. The rest of the reservoir now is going to really be volume, because there won't be any, it'll be all water. There won't be any valleys and things like that to fill in. So, but it is history in Walton County, and you need to go and take a look at it and see what's coming on. We'll have plenty of drinking water for many years to come, and it's just going to be something to have nice here in the county. That's about all I got for this week. If you have any questions or concerns, give me a call at 770-267-1301. Thank you.
Good morning. Thank you for watching. I'm Dina Hubb, the Executive Director for the Partnership for Families, Children, and Youth. And with it being a brand new year, I thought I would give you some information and background about what we're doing here at the Partnership. Let me just start by telling you who we serve. I'm the executive director. Like I said before, my responsibilities are bringing partners together. That is our focus, is partner engagement. I bring all partners together. We share common interest with families and children of Walton County. I do all the paperwork, try to find funding for programs that we may need in Walton County for our families and children. We also have a family services coordinator, Rick Baker, and you have seen him on the show before. And we also have a youth development director, Miss Amy Honeywell, and she works strictly with the youth of Walton County. Who we serve in Walton County. Like I said before, we serve families and children, and our collaborative meetings are once a month, and anyone is encouraged to attend those collaborative meetings. And we have those the third Tuesday of each month at 8 a.m. at Felker Community Center in Monroe. And during those meetings, I usually encourage or invite a couple of speakers to come share about what they have going on in the community for families and children. It could be a nonprofit, it could be a church, it could be an individual that has services for families and children. So, and we, you know, if you're interested in something like that, I would love to speak with you and invite you to be a speaker at one of our meetings. We also have a time for announcements if you have announcements that you need to get out into the community. During the fiscal year 16, which we're currently in, starting July, we will change over to the fiscal year 17. Well, during the fiscal year 16, our focus is on decreasing risky behaviors of our youth. We're going to change our focus a little bit in FY17. So you'll see some changes occurring within our department or our organization. We want to include a focus on poverty and homelessness. We work very closely with FISH, and we have seen an increase in homelessness, especially in our teens 17, 18, and above. So there's a concern countywide, and we want to make sure that those needs are met for those youth and families. So we will include that in our plan for FY17. Our plans are to do a community needs assessment, and we will have different focus groups. So you may see us coming around at different churches, different events, just to get your information and your input on what needs to happen here in Walton County. We are here to bridge gaps in services, make sure there are no duplications in services, and bring partners together because we all share a common interest, and that's for the families and children in Walton County. So if you'd like to be a part of what we do here at the partnership, we invite you. We need your help. You're a resident of Walton and you live here. You want to see the best for the families in your community, in your neighborhood. So I invite you to call me, to email me, and attend our collaborative meetings. So if you have any questions for us or you want to join the collaborative, please call me on my direct line here at the partnership, 770-207-3175. Thank you for watching.
Hello, I'm Kenny Sargent with Keep Walton Beautiful and the Walton County Recycling Center. I want to thank everyone for tuning in today. We're just wrapping up our Bring One for the Chipper event and want to thank everybody that participated in that. We had upwards of 100 trees brought in this year, and that was a little more than we had last year, but we do want to keep trying to advertise that and make that a little bit bigger every year. We know there's a lot more than 100 Christmas trees out there in the county, so we're going to try to do a better job advertising for that, and hope that continues to grow in the future. But again, thank everybody that did bring their Christmas trees. We've already got those chipped up, and we have the mulch here at the recycling center. Around the center, it's been very busy, which is a little bit different this time of year. Normally when school starts back and it starts to cool off, we slow up around the center, and that has not been the case. Last month we had 1,500 cars come through to put out trash here at the recycling center. So that's very busy for us, and it's normally a time when we can kind of regroup, get things cleaned up, and focus a little more on processing our recyclables. So it's been a bit of a challenge to keep up with all of the people we've had coming through. But we appreciate those people coming through. We feel like we're getting the word out there about ourselves, and it's just continuing to grow. So on that note, like I always do, I will remind anyone, if you haven't heard about us, don't know exactly what we do here, feel free to give us a call, 770-267-1421, or just come down here to the center. It's 2051 Leroy Anderson Road. We'll be happy to show you around, show you what we do, answer any questions you have, and we look forward to seeing you.
Hi, this is Jody Johnson. I'm here with the Recreation Report, and today we're going to go off in a little different way than what we normally do. I know when we talk about the sports programs and all the other activities that we have, but today I want to look behind the scenes. I know a lot of our parks, and we have some of the best parks in the area, state of Georgia, if not further. We have some of the cleanest, some of the safest. And we do a lot of that ourselves. And today I've got two of the guys that make that happen. And I've got, we call him Junior, but it's Ralph Lumpkin and Chris Haney. So thank you guys. They happened to walk in and I said, let's do a show. So Ralph, let's go to you first. And what are some of the things you do on a daily basis to help our parks stay clean and safe?
On a daily basis, we try to go to all the parks and make sure there's no trash on the ground, all the trash cans are emptied, make sure there's no debris on the ground for anybody to get hurt while they're playing, and make sure that everything's safe for all the children.
What are the names of some of the parks that you go to? I know that's one of y'all's main goals, is y'all go to what we call the passive parks. I know y'all aren't at most of the large parks. Y'all aren't for the most part at Criswell or you know, I know you're at Felker some, or West Walton or South Walton. Y'all are at a lot of the smaller passive parks. Name some of those.
We go to Gratis, we go to Good Hope, we go to McGarity, which is in Jersey. We go to Hammond Park and Matthews Park, and
that's good. And we also have Chris Haney here, and Chris is a local guy that's been around these parks for a while and has worked in our department for a while. So Chris, tell us how the seasons changed, and I know we go from the spring to the summer and the fall and the winter, and tell us a little bit how things change and how your duties change throughout the year.
Well, it all depends on your location. Each location dictates how you maintain it. They all have different grasses, so you have to do different types of duties to maintain it. So not each park is all the same. So when you have a transition, and not every year is the same, so it don't happen. Yeah, it don't happen all the same every year. So you have to be mindful of that and take mental notes all the time as you transition from spring to summer to fall to winter. So we have different equipment to take care of different types of areas, the different types of acreage, and also it's just.
What do we do? I know almost every one of the parks you go to have a playground. You know, what is some of the maintenance we have to do on playgrounds? Because those are difficult to keep up, from the mulch to the.
Yes, sir. The main thing is a lot of the swing areas get dug out a lot, so we have to always maintain our level of thickness on our mulch, mm-hmm. to keep it safe. As far as the equipment, we always maintain the chains or the plastic barriers that go around them. They drove in by metal stobs, so we have to make sure they're not cracked or broke where anybody could get their foot caught or cut or anything like that.
You'll have a checklist that y'all go by weekly, yeah. and make sure that those playgrounds,
yes,
stay safe.
Yes, sir.
And a lot of people don't think of that. They just think you put the playground up and that's it. And, you know, there's certain fall zones that we have to for those playgrounds to make it safe. For every 1 foot that an object goes up, we've got to have 2 feet out of fall zones, and we maintain an inch for every height of playground. The mulch, and we use some type of wood chips. And you know, those things float, they wash, they decay. So there's a lot that goes on with these playgrounds. And we have, I think, somewhere around 20 different playground sets. And those things are very expensive. So we want to make sure they stay clean. You know, when somebody goes out and they decide they're going to eat lunch and they spill ketchup on it, well, these are the guys that have to go out and scrape that stuff off. And it's, it's a tireless job, and sometimes it doesn't go, a good thank you goes a long way, because we do have some really nice clean,
yes,
parks. Our pavilions are nice. We have a lot of family reunions. We have a lot of birthday parties. a lot of retirement parties, baby showers, you name it, it's a special occasion. It goes on at one of your Walton County parks. So, and we have four or five guys that go over to about 200 acres and cut the grass during the season. They maintain the playgrounds, they maintain the parking lots, they maintain all the shrubbery that goes on. So these guys stay extremely busy at all these parks. It's a very tireless job, and again, they do it with very minimal staff. We do have some good equipment that the Walton County Board of Commissioners have given us to maintain that. So we're fortunate that we do have some good equipment that allows our few maintenance guys to stretch their time even further. So we appreciate that. I know they appreciate that. We got some really good equipment last year, so that
yes,
really
sir.
Helped
that,
them out a
that
lot.
That boosted us, especially our confidence
yeah,
of getting the job done.
Yeah, well, it took one guy with a mower that's 10 foot wide and basically expanded their time so they can look at some of the shrubberies and the playgrounds. It, basically, you know, your 40 hours get stretched, and when it's a rainy two or three days during the week, I know you are even stretched even thinner.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
A lot of y'all's conversation goes is how far have you gotten through the schedule this week? and on a normal week, you can get done by Thursday, but on a rainy week, you may go to the following Monday where you
yes,
fall
sir.
Behind. So, again, I wanted to get these guys on and thank them. They do a good job. And during the winter months when the grass isn't growing, that's when they catch up on all the projects that they may have let slide because of the time restraints that they had. And that's when they get into the gyms, the community centers, and help clean up those spots. So Ralph and Chris, we do appreciate it. You'll do
Thank
a great
you.
Job. And we hope that the spring will come early this year, because I know everybody wants to get outside.
Mm-hmm.
I also want to remind everyone that the community centers are open, and we hope you'll get inside and start exercising, live healthy, and keep that New Year's resolution that everyone about this time starts to sway upon. So stay in the community centers. It's a great bargain at $2 per week per family. We have some great equipment in there for you to exercise with, and on these cold nights that you can get up there and walk on the 116th mile walking trail. So we hope that everyone will do that. Our basketball season's coming to an end now, so we're getting close to our county championships. That's a lot of fun for the teams to finally get into a competitive tournament, and we'll play this week through next Saturday around the 23rd, I think we'll be through with our recreation basketball, and then we'll focus on All-Stars. Our baseball and softball track and soccer registration has completed. If you haven't gotten your child, grandchild registered, make sure you get into the Felker Community Center or Meridian Community Center or down at South Walton Park to get your child registered. There are a few slots left, but by the time this airs, you would hopefully have gone in and got your child registered. If not, give them a call immediately. Time is of the essence to get them in there if you want to sign up for this year's spring season. Numbers are held very steady, and looking forward to a great season. We'll start our evaluations and drafts here in the early months, or late January, early February. We'll start doing that and get our uniforms ordered. And we'll start playing our games in March. So spring is upon us already. We've got our adult basketball season about to kick off here in the next couple of weeks. So a lot of sports activities, a lot of things happening in the community centers. And our guys over here are gearing up for a season to get the parks ready for everybody to have that spring fever, because it's coming up soon. So we appreciate everyone going out. Remember, go to our website at waltoncountyga.gov. It's the best place to get all of our information. It's on there. Our senior fitness class is doing real well, with over 100 seniors every day at that activity. So if you've got a senior in mind, or you're a senior, you want to get out and exercise, a great place to go. So we hope to see you at a park soon. And as always, remember, sportsmanship starts at home. So until next time, thank you.
Hey, I'm Isaac with Reboot Computer Company, and we're going to give you the Reboot Tech Tip today. I want to talk a little bit about Wi-Fi networks. You know, you can go to Best Buy or Walmart or whatever and get these crazy Wi-Fi routers that look like spiders if you turn them upside down. They got all these antennas and all kind of craziness. You know, those things look cool, and you know, they do a lot of cool stuff, but a lot of times when people go and buy those things, they think that's going to give you better range. So like you put it in your house and you're like, oh yeah, it'll cover my house and the next door neighbors and all this stuff. And it's just not the case. The Wi-Fi signal has a hard time going through walls, and you may get through a wall or two, and then, or you know, a floor, maybe two, maybe, you know, but that's about the extent of your range that you're going to get. So like we have a customer that went out and bought one and just didn't cover his whole house, and he was upset. And, so what you can do if you have a big house or if you have a big business, you know, there's a couple things you can do. You know, obviously the best answer is to run cable everywhere. That's always quickest. You know, it's just quicker than wireless. It works better. It's more secure. All that stuff. So if you can run cable, you know, that's the best idea, especially for businesses and stuff like that. You know, if you can't run cable and you still need to have Wi-Fi all over the place, you can do what's called Wi-Fi extenders or Wi-Fi repeaters. And basically what you do is you install your router and then you install this Wi-Fi extender, and it hooks up to the, basically to the signal coming from the router. And then it rebroadcasts it. And so if you have that little box in another room, it'll rebroadcast in that room. And it may cover another couple rooms or, you know, another floor or something like that. And that'll help you out. But again, the best thing to do is always to run cable. You know, I think most houses, though, these days don't have places where you can run cable. So Wi-Fi is definitely the answer. But anyway, so don't go out and buy that $300 router. You can get you like a regular one for $60 or whatever, and maybe a repeater for $20 or $30, and that'll help you out. That's it for today. I'm Isaac Rhodes giving you the Reboot Tech Tip.
Hi, I'm Dr. April Mitchell, and I'm one of the veterinarians at the Monroe Vet Clinic. And today I'd like to talk about the importance of having your dog's teeth and cat's teeth checked yearly. Dental disease is a huge problem that we see in both our feline and canine patients, and it can be a really painful problem. And a lot of people do notice the smell of their pet's breath. They can have really bad halitosis when they have dental disease. But oftentimes it's hard to really get a good look at your pet's teeth, and so it is very important to have a dental exam performed at least yearly. There can be all kinds of bacteria and particles that can get up under the gum line. When we do dental cleanings here, one of the main things we see, which is kind of disgusting, is hair. They can have hair, their own hair, packed up under the gums that can cause a severe gingivitis and inflammatory response. Left untreated, the gums will continue to deteriorate their integrity and cause pockets, and these pockets can lead to all kinds of infection, actual tooth decay, and root exposure, which root exposure can then lead to, you know, loose teeth and tooth abscesses and things like that. So prevention is definitely the key. Just like in your own teeth, going to the dentist is very important. Brushing your teeth every day multiple times is very important. I'm kind of a tooth fanatic. I've never had a cavity, and I'm terrified every time that I'm going to go that I will have one. But in our dogs and cats, it's not always so easy to brush their teeth. Some dogs are very willing to allow that to happen, and that's great if you can do that. Cats are not big fans of that, so it's really important to have a veterinarian, you know, check those teeth and make sure they're healthy. As cats and dogs age, the risk of dental disease does increase. So if you have questions, or if you would ever like to have a, you know, dental exam done, please, you know, feel free to contact a veterinarian, because they would be glad to set something up with you. February in our area is dental month, so we do offer free dental exams, and you know, special things towards, you know, having a dental cleaning done on your pet. In dogs and cats, you can't just do a professional dental cleaning without them being under anesthesia. So anesthesia is part of that process. So it is really important to have your animals monitored and have their teeth cleaned, you know, before you have an emergency tooth abscess, because it is really painful. People that have had a toothache before can understand how painful that could be. So imagine you have six teeth in your mouth that are all hurting like that. And dogs and cats oftentimes don't stop, you know, eating. I always have people say, well, they're eating great. Well, they are eating great. They're probably just swallowing the food and not even trying to chew anymore. So please take advantage of Dental Month and have your pet examined, and let's see what we can do. Thank you.
Hey there, thanks for tuning in. As always, we're going to show you dogs and cats that are here at Walton County Animal Control. But first, I want to make you aware that the Atlanta Humane Society is coming back to Walton County again. This is an excellent deal. They bring a big trailer that's fully equipped with a spay-neuter clinic inside. Dog neuters are only $40 and cat neuters are only $35. So an incredible price, you can't really beat that anywhere. It's gonna be in March, but the sign-ups start January 24th. So if you're interested, you definitely wanna get in on the sign-ups. It'll probably fill up really quick. They are not taking walk-ins this year and an appointment is required. So again, $40 dog neuter, $35 cat neuter. It's gonna be at the Tractor Supply in Monroe in March, but sign-ups begin January 24th. You can sign up by calling Heidi at 678-517-2143. So starting on the 24th, give her a call and get signed up and get your pet fixed. You know, we had a lot of puppies and kittens this last season. We have a slowdown right now for the winter, but we really don't want it to pick up again. As soon as the days are getting longer and start to get warmer, if your animal's not fixed, it's gonna come into heat and the boy dogs are gonna chase all over the neighborhood. So you'll end up having puppies, but do this first so that we don't have to have more and more dogs coming into the shelter system and possibly being euthanized. So starting January 24th, call Heidi for that appointment. Now we'll show you some of the animals that are here.
We have us here a red pit, mama pit, and she's looking for a good home. You can see how nice and sweet she is. Looks like she's got a couple of marks on her head. She's glad to be away from where she was, and she'd like to be away from here too, if you'd like to give her a home.
Male terrier mix, probably about five-ish, not neutered, looking for a good home.
This is Pepper. She's a mix, probably about a year old. She's already spayed. She's had her shot. She's been dewormed, and she's very sweet, just a little bit shy, and just needs a good home.
Here we have a male Chihuahua mix. He's 2 to 3 years old. He is heartworm positive, but really sweet. He's a little timid at first, but he's really sweet and needs a good home.
Where do you come alive? A stadium, lecture hall, a music hall, church potluck? This year, you have a new spot, walkgeorgia.org, a free website that provides you with all the resources needed to get your heart rate up and body out in your community. Sign up and receive individual or group fitness tracking, fitness demos by certified trainers, recipes, and a guide to resources in your Georgia county, all in one easy-to-use site. When you move more, you live more. WalkGeorgia.org.
And the moon turns to rust. What's the worst that can happen?
Converting your VHS, CVHS, 8mm, and mini-DV to DVD. Preserve your family's video history for the generations to come. Creative Artists, 1113 West Spring Street, Monroe, 770-267-7368.